Penguin Random House Audio presents The Goldblum Variations. Adventures of Jeff Goldblum Across the Known and Unknown Universe by Helen McClory. Read for you by Jonathan Davis. A Variety of Jeff Goldblums. The Jeff Goldblum that lathes and sands down a pine table, brushing the grain with the heel of his hand, bends down and takes a spirit level to it, saying gently to the wood, "Well done, you." The Jeff Goldblum that wakes up in the morning, opens the curtains and says softly, "Oh." The Jeff Goldblum that in an excitable mood makes his maid an origami peacock and leaves it on the top of the fridge, where she, being short, cannot reach it without his helpful boost. The Jeff Goldblum that has never forgotten your birthday, having chanced upon it in the Wikipedia article about you, which he has started to contribute to, although he doesn't really know anything about you at all. And while his contributions are always peevishly removed by moderators, he is only writing kind and harmless things, like saying, "Your favorite color is pink," when, citation needed, it might not be so, though it might be, because he, Jeff Goldblum, has surmised a favorability toward pinkness in you, stranger. The Jeff Goldblum that lets tears flow when he deadheads his roses in winter. The Jeff Goldblum that is listening to these stories with his chin in his hands. The Jeff Goldblum that is listening to these stories with his head in his hands. The Jeff Goldblum that stands in mirth in a frosty walled garden with an armful of ranunculus he has just set alight. The Jeff Goldblum that lies awake at night contemplating the creator slash the existence of the creator, debating out loud on top of his blankets in a lengthy diatribe, or coming to conclusions rapidly and without a frisson of despair in the least. The Jeff Goldblum that is a sometimes murderous, sometimes mundane figment in the dream of a woman with aching ankles in Kirkintilla. The Jeff Goldblum that rages at the impossibility of opening hard plastic packaging and, growing increasingly frantic, throws the offender in question, a sealed shut package of scissors, across the room, frightening a visiting dog, and leaving him, Jeff Goldblum that is, with a momentary feeling of vertigo at his own emptiness. The Jeff Goldblum that cannot find his glasses. I think you know where they are. The Jeff Goldblum that is being the best version of himself. Jobs for Jeff Goldblum. Firefighter in a ghost town in the desert of Arizona. Jeff Goldblum sits in his bunk room, one bed, neatly against the wall, a calendar with monthly pictures of Jeff Goldblum in sexy poses, which he did for charity and also for himself, listening for the alarm to sound, which it has never yet. A brusque wind is lifting the sand outside in thin laces and at the same time shoving one tumbleweed that he can see inexorably around the chain-link fence that marks the perimeter of his station. Artist in a Cold War bunker. Jeff Goldblum is running out of things to sketch and paint. Undeterred, he begins a new project, a recreation of the world itself as he experiences it. Delicately following the lines of the corridors, finding and painting each rivet and scuff mark on the blast walls onto canvas after canvas. He does not think of the world up top. Gray, pink, yellow, gray, gray, gray. There are quite enough colors even here, and even though he does not know all their names, for him to turn his mind to forget. Sprite in a computer game. Jeff Goldblum persists on going against his programming. He is in a battlefield sim, but he has decided he should be much more about gardening right now. The main part of his army has massed at the foot of the hill and is being charged by the cavalry of the enemy. Jeff Goldblum's apple crop, despite lacking detail, is coming in well this year. Mathematician in a well-regarded university. Jeff Goldblum has written out one formula on the giant whiteboard for his students to copy. Its purpose is unknown to Jeff Goldblum and to his students alike, but look closer and you will realize swiftly he has intuited the formula for the perfect tortoise. Town drunk in a glaciated plateau. Jeff Goldblum tries and fails to get into trouble. The town is 40 yards below him, locked in the ice. One must admire his devotion to attempting minor breaches of the peace via graffiti and public urination here, where there is no public, where there are no longer any buildings worth cherishing. Detective in a gated community. Jeff Goldblum expected he would swiftly run out of things to investigate, but has found that there's always plenty of drama. Even laying aside all that come from the cliched notion of residents as prisoners inside the various matryoshka of their days, consider, as he does, the mystery of the last leaf on the maple tree in front of the concierge's office. When will it fall? Who will take it when it does? Clown, hitching from habitation to habitation across Russia. Jeff Goldblum is filled with a sense of freedom, but also deep unease. His pockets are full of dusty balloons and lollipops. He keeps hearing bees and men yelling. There is never anything around him but the open road and the forest or fields through which one large tractor is slowly charging. Public defender in a small unnamed country. Jeff Goldblum is unfamiliar with not only statute and case law, but also with the basic practice of being a lawyer. He is trying his best to provide adequate representation for those who cannot afford to secure a lawyer themselves. Mostly, the people of the courtroom are pleased to see him, a celebrity. Quite often, there is undue noise. One day, a joyous fight broke out between a witness for the prosecution and a juror. Jeff Goldblum resolved this by signing both of their stomachs in his blood, allowing proceedings to continue. Writer of short absurdist fiction. Jeff Goldblum, no, I cannot. I should just stop it here. Look, I'm already getting dizzy and sick. I am thinking too much of his fingers typing through and over my own, sliding into the space where my joints are, although, being longer, the fit is not correct, and we hit the keys at a delay from each other. Oh no, this is just wrong! I apologize for ever beginning on this path. Cooking with Jeff Goldblum. Announcer. Good evening and welcome to another Cooking with Jeff Goldblum, or rather, hello for the first and final time. It's midnight, the clocks are all asleep, and we're cooking with Jeff Goldblum. Now give a warm witching hour hiss to the man himself, Jeff Goldblum! Jeff Goldblum enters and crosses the room in big lanky strides until he reaches the cooking space, pushes his glasses up his nose, smiles, puts his hand on the wooden counter, takes in the audience and the noise of their hissing and cheers. Announcer. So, Jeff Goldblum, what are you preparing for us tonight? We're all hungry. We're all waiting. I have my bib on. I love you. Jeff Goldblum pulls up a basket from under the counter. An overhead camera shows the audience that the basket is full of mushrooms, homely, white and brown things with little flecks of dirt on their warm-looking nubs and gills. Announcer. Wow, look at those lads! Jeff Goldblum pulls up a large stock pot and puts it on the stovetop, then shows the audience inside his sleeve. There is nothing. He shows the other sleeve. Nothing. He waves his hands and claps. Suddenly, he is holding a peeled shallot. He begins chopping this on the counter. He minces it very finely and puts it in the stockpot. He lights the flame under the stockpot and sweats the shallot. Then he produces a jug of vegetable stock. Announcer, is that vegetable stock? Nice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.